in Trump America, it's gonna be huge, huge, huge. Just like the boner that Trump doesn't have. We're gonna build a wall. It's gonna be a great wall.
Beautiful.
It's beautiful. It's gonna be the biggest wall, bigger than my wife's fake tits. I've been Donald Trump. Thank you. Trump out.
Aww. All right, how's it going? I'm John Rayl, here with a couple special guests you probably know if you've been watching the lovely Anna Maltese, Archer Fire Dancer, Badass Extraordinaire,
well,
and the Psy Babe.
Well, hello, thank you for having me.
Psy Babe, who loves the planetarium.
I'm here because we met once when John was wearing a G-string.
That is true. Mm-hmm.
Isn't that all how we meet him?
And it was before Saibe was even a little glimmer in my eye. I was friends with Penn. I was like, Penn's band puts on a show. I'm gonna go to the bacon and donut party.
Who is that?
So I was like, there's a guy wearing a G-string and pasties. And afterwards, I was hanging out in the hallway, and there was a man who I'd just seen in G-string and pasties. And I must say, I think he should walk around in it more often. I can see why Anna digs him. Mm.
That's
so moving
my
on.
Vote.
Does he do that at the house?
Not as much as I would like, but you know,
yeah,
I'm
I
not going to tell.
But they are all colored briefs.
John, I'm just saying, at least for birthday and for Arbor Day. Like, my birthday's coming up next week, too.
And
are you guys are invited to my dinosaur-themed birthday?
I'm definitely
Yay.
Out as a maybe. I should be there.
Moving on. So, met him, and we got to be friends on Facebook, and years later, Psybabe took off, and now I'm in the skeptic community, and it's been fun to reconnect with people that I met in a G-string, and their lovely, more politically inclined girlfriend, who we share a political brain. It's
yes.
so wonderful.
And so I just want to give you guys a forewarning. This is a this is a political video. I am still apolitical, which is why these ladies are going to take over any moment now and do their thing, because they went to Politicon. Is that the actual name of it?
Yes. My platform is Politicon 2016, and my platform is not political. I basically only talk about politics when I see a politician saying something that's wrong about science. So when Jill Stein rants on Reddit for like two paragraphs and won't about vaccines, and she's a doctor and she won't say that vaccines are safe and effective, or when Bernie is like GMOs are bad, or that women get cancer because they don't have enough orgasms. We should have more orgasms, but fuck you,
oh,
Bernie.
Oh yeah, that was a thing. That
he
was
said
a thing.
That.
I mean,
oh, yeah.
it was in his youthful days, but you know.
But here's the thing: because he lost the nomination and get over it, motherfuckers. I would have voted for him, but he lost. Okay, that's how that works. You don't get as many votes as the other guy. You don't get to be president. That's or dog catcher, whatever the fuck you're running for. But that's just how that works.
Also,
calm down.
Also, if this is your first time voting in the Democratic Party, this is actually a good primer for you, because as a member of the Democratic Party since I was 10, essentially. You learn what it is to have your heart broken often.
Oh yeah.
And congratulations, this is the start.
And candidates are gonna disappoint you, elections are gonna disappoint you. Life goes on. Now please, to anybody who joined the Democratic Party for this election, specifically to vote for Bernie, I plead you, don't run away saying I've been disenfranchised, my vote didn't count. Your vote counted, you just didn't win. There's a big difference. I implore you, if you think that Bernie's points of view should have his own party or should be better represented, please keep getting involved, especially at the local and state and town level, because that's where we see so much legislation get changed. Look in the mirror if you think nothing's changing.
I'm just gonna interrupt. That way I can step out. I just wanted to interject again. All those words and facts and stuff were about the sci-fi television series called Politics that I've never gotten into.
Oh, right. We're back to the disclaimer.
Fact,
right. Okay.
Yeah,
sorry.
In fact, I even go further in being apolitical. I give my vote away every primary, and you can see the videos on it. Links below. So continuing with the awesome political ladies.
Yvette, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you first heard about Politicon?
I'm the Psy Babe. I run a website that's mainly science and dirty jokes, because I figure if you're going to talk about science, you may as well tell a fucking dick joke, because I'm competing with funny pictures of cats and pornography when I'm on the internet, so why not make the science a little bit funny? That and I'm debunking a bunch of assholes who tell you that green juice can cure cancer. I'm like, no, it fucking can't. So again, I try to make the science funny and relatable, and again, dick jokes. But I'm also a bit of a political junkie. I've volunteered on two elections, and I love politics because I think I think they're, you know, it's fucking important. And I love going to things like Politicon because you sometimes get to meet some of the people that you've seen so much about. And Anna posted on Facebook. Now, Anna and I hadn't met before. I knew her boyfriend. But Anna and I hadn't met, and from across the internet, I, you know, we'd slowly gotten to
We looked at each other across a crowded room.
And it was, there was girlmance right away. And it's when she posted about Politicon, I'm like, oh, she's not just someone who posts about politics occasionally. She likes going to, you had me at hello, Anna. You had me at hello, so. She wanted to go to Politicon, and I was like, I want to go. Now, the funny thing was, my boyfriend is kind of apolitical, kind of like John, but my boyfriend gave a wishy-washy answer. He said, you know, I'm not really into politics, but if you want me to go with you, I'll go. I'm like, click purchase on two tickets. The next day, he's kind of whining about it and being like, I didn't really want to go. I'm like, then you sure said you didn't want to go. But he goes, and number one, we went to see Lady Parts Justice League, which I want justice for my Lady Parts. And this is a group of badass, motherfucking wonderful comics who are headed up by Liz Winstead,
who's co-creator of The Daily Show.
Oh yeah. So anyways, that was one of the really neat things that was there. And my boyfriend, being such a motherfucking bomb-ass feminist that he is, and for the record, feminist doesn't necessarily mean that doesn't mean at all that he is a pussy or a pushover. Because if you can handle me and my big old bag of bullshit, you're not a pushover. He goes to the Lady Parts Justice group and gets a big old shirt that says Lady Parts Justice on the front.
And so, we all got the little gold tattoos.
And there's a little gold.
Your eye.
And he had that thing does not come off.
No, I noticed that. It leaves an indelible mark for a little while.
He had it on for a week, so my boyfriend loved it.
I found out that Politicon existed when I was just browsing news feeds on WAPO or something. And at first I thought it was a joke. Like, where would this ever happen? How would this ever happen? It can't exist.
And how are all these people here? And it was in Pasadena. And we hadn't heard about it.
It was the second annual one. So one of them went by without any of my friends letting me know about them. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, it's a bunch of my libertarian friends were there. And I think they missed that I was going to it. Either that or they're so mad at me that I'm a Hillary supporter now that we're like, we're not talking to you. That
we'll touch on that later. Don't think we won't.
I'm like I love you guys, but we're allowed to disagree. It's part of democracy.
So the lineup was nuts.
Oh my God.
Gary Johnson, and I'm looking at the website, and I'm like, this is looking like it's an actual legit thing.
Yeah.
But Gary Johnson,
John McAfee,
Wendy Davis.
Wendy fucking Davis.
There was a panel with Ann Coulter and Van Jones. They even were hyping the panel with, like, who do you prefer, Ann or Van?
Oh,
and
God.
Everybody was like,
there was a Sarah Palin talk, which you got to go to. I did not.
You can speak
more to that one. But the James Carville Sarah Palin thing,
that was the highlight.
I needed a fucking cigarette after that, and I do not smoke. But man, that was
good. I'm
gonna
take that up now.
And then, of course, and we're gonna talk about this quite a bit, we met our new best friend, Michael fucking Steele.
So we decided, like, on the Facebook thing to go, and I had been assuming that it was all sold out.
Nope.
However, apparently it was not, and tickets were $30 for a day.
$30.
So something is crazy.
Oh yeah, I'm getting my agents to check if I can speak at it next year with a nutjob anti-GMO liberal, because man, that'll be some fun.
I may have just peed a little.
One of my friends who was a comic, who's a comic with Lady Parts Justice League. Her name is Joyelle. She's brilliant. She was backstage in the green room. She said Sarah Palin put an entire fucking can of hairspray on her hair, and I want to be backstage to see that.
So I got there, and I gotta say, the whole thing is not only populated by politicians and people in that realm, but comedians.
Oh yeah.
And it's billed, and this was what floored me, especially in this day and age when everything is so polarized, as a place where just, hey, if you like politics, come and enjoy.
And they said it's like the political, political convention. It's a weird, wacky, everyone's here right. political convention.
It's like with, it's a lot like, they were billing it as Coachella on their website.
Yeah.
It's not. It's a lot like Comic-Con.
Yeah, it's like, do you just like getting hyped up over politics? Well, we've got the convention for you. I feel like there's going to be an hour of tangents and 5 minutes of politics.
We're going to edit this the way the fuck down.
Okay, good.
So
you guys are probably better.
Editing than me. John is better at it. John Bet-editor. Handles all the...
The better editor.
He's
the
master.
All right.
So...
We love you.
It was a geek convention.
Oh, so...
And there were people... first of all, doing cosplay,
oh, yeah.
not just as Donald Trump, not just as Bernie Sanders, but Rince Priebus.
Oh, yeah.
And had the spectacle of the former RNC chair meeting somebody cosplaying the current one.
Oh, yeah.
And there were people there in, like, you know, with I'm With Her. There were people, you know, like, Feel the Burn. And there were people in Donald Trump hats, which I have not seen in real life before.
Well, we do kind of live in Southern California. We're not in the right place. But I had not seen a Trump hat other than on...
Endangered species out here.
No, it's there. We had not seen a Trump hat in, like, not other than on a news clip where they're interviewing people going, right. So what crazy shit are you going to say that I can use to make you look like an asshole because it's so easy? Like, that's the only place where I've seen a Trump hat yet. So, yeah, I hadn't even thought about that.
Yeah, and it was crazy. And the amazing thing was everybody was just milling around companionably.
And nobody was walking up to people going, you believe in this person, I hate you. Like, it's like Hillary and Bernie supporters who probably, like, some of them were probably still, if you were at this thing wearing a Bernie thing, you're probably a Bernie or Buster. Just a guess, I could be wrong. Or you're, you know, just wanting to have a conversation. Mm-hmm. Nobody was yelling. At one point, you had a conversation with a libertarian mayor of a small town.
Yes.
There was a bit of arguing, but it ended amicably. Like...
It was interesting because as soon as it did, we were like, oh shit, oh god, I'm so sorry. That Warner Brothers chipmunks, oh no, you're too kind. Oh no, by all means, after you.
You're a living cartoon character. It's so cute.
You have to be if you work in animation.
Ba-ba-da-bum.
But I think I'd like to hear your take on this because for me personally, I tend to approach politics as a sport. They do say it's sports for nerds. The thing is...
I say it a little differently, but close.
The thing is, it is sports that has the capacity to decide whether I live or die. The best response I saw during the healthcare debate was from Stephen Hawking, because I don't remember which politician it was who said this, but they said... If Stephen Hawking had been born in Britain and had been subject to socialized medicine, we would not have him around today. Stephen Hawking responded, he is British. It was because of the national health system that he was allowed to live. And he said... actually, everything you're saying is wrong.
Don't you mean you said, actually, everything you are saying is wrong.
Oh, God, we are so awful.
I love you, Stephen. Just saying, I love the fact that Stephen Hawking has gone to strip clubs in his free time.
Oh, yeah, that's nice.
He's
gone to strip clubs and... Into a low Earth orbit.
If you're Stephen Hawking, fucking cool. Go to strip clubs. We're good at tangents.
Right.
So guys talking about political con.
And somehow we got onto universal health care.
So Politicon was everything, oddly enough, that it was billed as being. It was by geeks, for geeks. And people from all across the political spectrum of today were there.
It's far to the really far to the left, really far to the right.
Like, people in Donald Trump hats were walking with people with Bernie Sanders t-shirts. People in, Wendy Davis and Gary Johnson were butting around.
I saw people holding Ted Cruz 2016 things. It wasn't even Ted Cruz for human president things. It was actual Ted Cruz 2016. I'm like, oh, damn. These are some holdouts.
Yeah. And that was really fun.
It was kind of political peace in the universe. Like, there were probably arguments, but it was kind of arguments in the spirit of conversation and ideas.
So the first thing I got to see, besides people watching, everybody walking around together happily, which was...
Cats and dogs living together.
Mass hysteria, which was awesome, was... And I have to put a disclaimer in front of this. I swear upon Theodore Roosevelt's spectacles, I was in line to see a live taping of Left, Right, and Center for noon. At 11:53, with 7 minutes to go, my feet just were taken over by something. They marched me out of the hall and across the street to Independence Hall to see... Sarah Palin, and I'm not proud of saying... Yeah, right. To,
May the good Lord that we don't believe in bless you, my child.
Praise Jesus.
Praise.
To see Sarah Palin. And...
Wait, how many minutes was she supposed to talk for?
So she had an hour slot. She...
I have jokes about this, but right. Because I like women, I'm going to be nice. If she can go for an hour, good for you. I hope I'm still going for an hour when I'm your age, Sarah. I hope.
I think it's all the, what's she, basketball in college that she
played. Actually, she's run a few marathons. And she
she's fit.
She had a better marathon time than I did. So I gotta fucking give her credit for, you know, she's.
All marathon time props. She did come on stage 15 minutes late and depart 20 minutes early without taking any questions.
I feel like that might have been on purpose.
You think?
I'm just saying, I don't know if Sarah has much to say other than you know, Obama and there or what, and Trump, America, greet again, wall. Like, I think that's pretty much her entire talk.
I sat down in the back row, and the game that I was playing with myself was which are the true believers and which are the rubberneckers. Ooh. And, you know, it's a fun game at that place because... There are people from all political stripes. There are people in Bernie t-shirts and you know, blue streaked hair and, you know, just, you know, the young hipsters. And there were people in Trump hats and t-shirts there to see the talk. So we're all here to watch the spectacle live that we have seen for the past 8 years on our computer monitors televisions.
They should have been giving you popcorn when you came in. I'm just saying.
We really should have. Well, I think the popcorn should have been for the James Carville interview because here's...
God, that was grand theater.
Sorry, carry on. Here's the thing. It was what... There were no surprises.
That's so sad.
If you were looking for surprises, there were none. And it was like, okay. And that was when it began to feel like a setup. But about 10 minutes after that, because we're all there. We're all seeing. We're okay, well, what's going to happen?
She's saying the same shit.
It's the same thing. We can play the Sarah Palin Mad Libs home version. By this point, like anybody who came a voting age in 08 can play the same thing. So about 10 minutes into this, me and the two ladies next to me were doubled over in laughter because we're like, this is all there is.
This is amazing.
This is it. And this is all that there ever shall be. And so that happened. That occurred. And afterward, what was interesting... was a reporter approached me from the Daily News. And he said, I saw you laughing. May I interview you? And I said, sure. So he sat down and he said, the first question out of his mouth was, so why do you think that people still keep giving Palin opportunities to speak? And, oh, irony, thy name is the Fourth Estate. So I'm like, well, that's a very good question. Why are you here?
I can think of so many reasons why they keep giving her reasons to speak.
Yeah,
because people love to fucking laugh, man.
It's because
we come for the show.
And he laughed and he said, well, that's a good question. And I said, so why are you here? And he said, well, my editor sent me. And I said, so why did your editor send you to cover Sarah Palin? And he said, well, because she's so unpredictable, you never know what's going to come out of her mouth next. And I said,
however,
I'm going to disagree with that. I don't think that's why we go see her. I wanted to see her live simply to, holy shit, is this going? Yeah. I did slip into that
it's
in the
real.
Moment. But when you're covering her and you're writing down her words, it's, and I told him this, it's noun, verb, adjective, misplaced adverb, emphasis on the incorrect syllable, and there you go. You can write a Sarah Palin speech. You know what words to fill in.
And it's kind of the proof of that, I think, and I hate to use, I love to use comedy as proof of this. Whenever a comedian does a Sarah Palin sketch, sometimes they don't even write the sketch. They just do her actual fucking speech, and it's funny. Sarah Palin, I don't think, the joke is that Sarah Palin doesn't know how funny she is. Like, that's the best part about this. Like, if she, I almost wonder sometimes if she knows. She worked as a mayor of a small city. She ran a fucking state. Okay, it's just Alaska, so it's the size of Richmond, Virginia. Republicans don't get too comfortable in me saying nice things about her. It's not gonna last. But I wonder if she's in, sometimes if she's in on the joke, and she knows, and she's like, fuck it, people are laughing. I like money. Let's milk this shit. Like that's a possibility. I don't think it's a big one. But you know what? You know who's laughing more than all of us? Sarah Palin and her goddamn mansion. Like, there was a great clip on, it was either the Daily Show, no, it was Last Week Tonight, saying here are offenses that once upon a time were thought of as horrible things. And one of them was Al Gore sighing.
Yeah.
And one was George Bush Sr. Looking at his watch.
Oh my God, how naive we were.
It's, I remember when we thought Joe Biden was a gaffe machine. Oh, we were so naive. How naive we were. But unfortunately, people like Sarah Palin get asses in seats. Like people, and I don't know if people can separate out the great entertainment value from the fact that we need somebody to do this huge job of running the country. And like the presidenting thing is, I look at it as kind of a job of working with a lot of moving parts. And this is why people like Obama, people like Hillary, and even people like John McCain, version 2000, would have been...
Version 2000.
Oh, yeah, I like McCain, even though I disagreed with him on some things, but I saw him as someone who's capable, like, and competent to do that. Big, big things. But, like, looking at the candidates available now, it's like, who can work with all these moving parts? That's a huge thing for presidenting. So we were all kind of salivating about this because one of the things that we love about politics is not just watching one person get up and rant, because we already know the one opinion. Watching two people who disagree going head to head, it's a big old political boner. Like I'm wet just thinking about it.
This was the thriller in vanilla.
Oh, and I love James Carville. He looks like his forehead is eating his face, and I dig it. I want to turn his entire face into a dildo. It's so smooth,
and
so shiny.
And he's married to Mary Madeline.
You know.
On the exact opposite sides of working on campaigns.
You know that there have been some nights where someone's been sleeping on a couch, or when there's been some hot makeup sex.
That's a spicy Louisiana marriage. What we gonna do here? Though lovingly on metaphor and simile.
You can't get a rattlesnake into a hole without a honey badger making it angry about the.
Now the first thing he did, which was fun to watch, is just a little aside, was he came out, took off his coat and started rolling up his sleeves, and everybody was like, "Oh shit, it's gonna go down!"
It's on. Now it's any, and here's one of the other little things we noticed later on. We took pictures when he sat down. His pant leg went up a little bit, and he had really cute socks.
Saucy.
We were digging the James Carville festive socks. Moving on.
He stated flat out, I'm not, and it kind of set the tone for the convention. I'm not going to change Sarah Palin's mind. She's not going to change my mind. But we're going to have a dialogue, and we're going to at least understand each other's minds a little bit better.
Which I'm not on enough drugs to understand Sarah Palin's mind, but it was nice of him to try. Now, for the first part of this, you can't tell in the audience how, like she just said, how homogenous it is, how many You know, if you're sitting in a part of the audience where you're about to get shanked because you show that you're anti-Sarah, or if you're sitting around Trumpy people or you know, like, and I looked around and there's someone behind me with a Hillary shirt, and there look to be enough people around that are pro-Democrat-y and that are, you know, that probably won't kill me. And I start to hear some giggles. And because, you know, she said some funny shit. And then, you know, unintentionally funny shit. You know, she didn't know it was funny, but we did. Like, then someone asked a question about Trump. And she goes, Donald Trump has been in the public eye for... Sorry, I had to get my Sarah voice on. Oh, Donald Trump has been in the public eye for 30 years, and nobody has ever accused him of saying a racist thing now. So I think it's the lamestream media or something like that. And at this point... my boyfriend Anna and I think it started with me laughing so hard that I couldn't fucking contain it, because we've been doing that like laugh, like, you know,
we tried,
like, you know, shoulders shaking, but we're not laughing out loud. Like,
I still have tooth marks on the insides of my cheeks.
Like, we started laughing out loud so hard that I was sure they were gonna kick me out, and I kept laughing for like a minute because I just couldn't fucking stop. Like, it was built up from, like, you know, the first 20 minutes of it had to be like 20 minutes into it at least. Yeah. I just kept laughing, and everyone around me is looking at me like, "Am I allowed to laugh now? We're gonna keep laughing with it." Like, it built up like an entire section of the audience laughing.
The reactions were completely organic. There were cheers from the true believers.
Oh yeah.
There were the gut laughs and boos from the rubberneckers.
Yeah, it's like there was a ton of booing when she said that, and I just laughed because I was like, oh shit, it is on now. Like, because she just, it's as soon as you pull the Trump has never said anything racist. I'm like. Like, I don't think people would have accepted or would have gone along with a Trump candidacy if there hadn't been a Sarah Palin type figure out there first. I don't think I don't think the media would have accepted it. I think, you know, some voters, there would have been a crazy contingent out there, but I don't think they would have been primed. I was about to make a really horrible joke and I'm holding back on it. Like, I don't think they were primed. No, I am going to make it. I think they were only primed enough for this type of political molestation because Sarah Palin porns them up a little bit with some disturbing stuff.
We're going to be asking the American electorate later to show us on the doll where Sarah Palin touched it.
And if you have any complaints about that joke I made, leave them in the comments where I will promptly ignore them and tell you I don't care.
I have a special folder all set for that.
I'll be crying so much about the things you say that are mean about me. I know I'm a fat whore already. It's okay. You can just keep making the comments. It's okay.
I think she definitely, and this is just my take, she definitely enabled more of that to be okay.
Yeah.
And that's why she was hired on. I think you can find precedent for her in George Bush and the anti-intellectualism, which there has been a strain of in America for quite some time.
Oh, yeah. It started back in, like, the 80s with Ronald Reagan. And here's the sad thing. If you look at the politics of Reagan versus the politics of, you know, the current Republican Party, man, Reagan looks so good. Amnesty, responsible gun control.
Yep.
Like, and they all talk about him like he's Saint Reagan. Man, if they could take some advice from Saint Reagan, I would like to sit down a few of them who think Saint Reagan everything. I'm like, let's have a look at some of his policies. And George H.W. Bush left the NRA because of their insane policies. Like, last week, and I sit down with farmers and talk to them for a living, bunch of Southern Dairy farmers who are all gun owners. They're like, who? And they were in Florida. They were all like, yeah, I don't need an AR-15. They're like, I have a gun, but we don't need a, and I know there are a lot of people who are, you know, very emotionally driven about the term assault rifles. They're like, what the fuck do you need an AR-15 for? So, I mean, I'm not saying ban all guns. I'm saying we do need a little bit more responsible gun control. And George H.W. Bush agrees with that. Like, it's, you know, the fact that he was so far off of where the current Republican party is and where all the talking points are. Come on, guys. Can't you, this is, we'll get into this a little bit more after when we talk about our good friend Michael Steele. But it was crazy being in the room watching James Carville and, you know, trying to ask questions and trying to get, you know, any amount of straight answers out, because it was nutty. At one point, oh, this is great, the Q&A came up.
Oh.
And the kid was the fucking hero of the day.
So we have to give props to this 10-year-old kid who was a member of the press, and I did not prep his name, but He asked her, how can you, you know, support Donald Trump as a woman when he said about Megyn Kelly, a 10-year-old reference, I want to subscribe to this kid's newsletter. I don't care. Yeah. You know, I will support his it's whatever.
10-year-old.
Yeah. Like you. And, you know, how can you support him as a woman when he said Megyn Kelly has blood coming out of her wherever? And her default was, he's not a sexist. I wouldn't be voting for him if he was.
That's a complete lack of an answer. That's not how answers work. That's just saying, well, it's kind of like saying after someone says, you know, they're rapists, they're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime. Well, I don't think that's not, it's, well, what if he said that about all Alaskans? We have to build a wall between here and Alaska. Like, that's direct, like, that's the exact definition of someone saying a shitty thing about a widespread group of, you know, people. But, like,
it kind of
blood
is
coming out of her wherever. Really?
And that was the interesting thing, because James Carville did his level best. He said,
reach across the table and murder her.
So basically, like, regardless of where you are on the political spectrum, that was the event to be at.
Yeah.
I mean, as soon as I got inside from
big old political
from another area in there, I saw this huge line and I'm like, this has got to be,
this is it.
James Carville and Sarah Palin were awesome. And it was, no matter where you go on the political spectrum, it was the event to be at.
If you have a if you're interested in politics and love it and just like to see an interesting discourse and you have a chance to see something like that, go.
In 2012, right, the Obama coalition showed that the sorry, white men, the
sorry.
This is gonna sting a little.
Just it's okay. You'll be okay.
And I apologize.
You'll get through it.
For that. We're all gonna get through this together. Showed that Romney won with I forget if it was 59% or 62% of the white male vote, and he lost
still strong
the presidency, and that even if Trump garners the same percentage of the white vote, which he's by the snapshots in time that polls are probably not going to do, but even if he does, there
guess
are not
what?
Enough of those voters to let him win. Unless, and again, polls are snapshots in time.
But let's think about this. How many people are so disgusted by all the shit he says that they're not going to vote for him, especially given that 70% of women and something like 85 to 95% of black people are like,
He's pulling at 1% with black
folks. 1%?
By some.
I want to meet the 1%.
Yeah. I think a more inclusive, diverse America fulfills what this nation's soul is supposed to be about.
And it's very interesting to me that, like, we are not all that far removed, like, from this, you know, from the signs in windows saying Irish need not apply.
From the Jim Crow era.
And I mean, people seem to think this is a long time ago. Like, I grew up in Boston, which, I hate to say it, horribly racist city. Like, not as bad anymore. But, like, there was an era really not that long ago in history where people remember how racist Boston was. Gotten a lot better, and it's because it's gotten a lot more diverse, and people have gone, hey, look, people who look a little different than me are still human and have the same wants and needs and are pretty much the same as me. But as long as we keep having people that are in the public eye and we accept that they say horrible things about people that are a little different than them because they have a different skin color or a different accent or they come from a different country, and this still is continued to be accepted, we're just accepting people being shitheads to other people, and this is not going to help us grow and be more diverse. Like, we started accepting, like, every so often a new wave of immigrants comes into the country, and it changed, like, you know, for a little while we're a little uncomfortable because we're like, I don't get what's going on, something's different in here, I don't know how this is happening. And then, you know, the cultural landscape of the country changes a little bit, and things get groovy again. Like, there's, you know, the place changes, and it's not, I don't know if I want to say it's for better or worse, but you know what? like the fabric gets a little bit updated. That's, and it's nice. Like that's keeps the country kind of it's like a thing of Febreze only for the culture of the country. there's a thing where in order to actually get out and help out your constituents, you have to talk to them and see what their concerns are. And by just going in and saying, here's what our stance is and you have to take it, that's not gonna, like, it's, you can't shove anything down someone's throat. They're gonna gag it back up. That's just, I'm just saying.
You have to ease past the gag reef.
Yeah, you have
Yeah,
you have to get consent before you work on deep throating. I'm just saying, it can be lovely, but it's not for politics.
It's not, and but, not suddenly.
But I mean, here's the thing, like the way you build a consensus is by, you know, finding out how, you know, where you two have things in common. Just by saying legal immigration is good, illegal immigration is bad. That's such a, it's not just a black and white point of view. It ignores all the problems within the immigration system and the fact that there are people already living here who came because they wanted the American dream. They wanted to be able to say crazy shit like Sarah Palin and be able to get paid for it. And it was, I promise, I don't think any immigrant is that crazy.
I actually had an experience previous to that as essentially a true believer at a panel hosted by Mark Thompson and Ture, who I have to give all props to. It was a fast-paced, the panel was Clinton and African Americans, It's Complicated. And wow. It went into race in America, history in America, and they're first of all, their mannerisms and styles are awesome. Like, one's an author and a podcaster. Mark Thompson is kind of, you know, been on the front lines and kind of a grizzled, you know, warrior type, very professorial, and Ture is just like ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. And they were fantastic. And I was looking around the room, like, okay, well, who's the rubbernecker, who's the true believer? And I couldn't really tell. There were two guys in front of me in very tight-fitting plaid pastel shirts who had shaved heads, and there was a tattoo, and I was kind of like, but at the same time, they were sitting there perfectly, and I'm not saying they were skinheads, but there was this interesting situation where I'm like, okay, this is where I'm a true believer. I am totally on board with what they're saying about progressivism, how the parties have interacted with the black vote, how they've interacted with voters of color over the years, and this is how people hear Sarah Palin, who support her.
Yeah,
and
that's an interesting thought.
Except for the fact, two facts. First of all, they were bringing in data. They were bringing in numbers and like, okay, well, then that parallels with this and this and this and that and the other thing. And also, while being very respectful in the spirit of the event to anyone who might disagree with their points of view, they were very plain with, you know, okay, look, these are the demographics. This is how it's changing. This is where history's headed.
Yeah.
So it was a very interesting comparison between Sarah Palin's, like, you know, well, we're, you know, with James Carville's question of how do you stay relevant as the Republican Party when you're losing elections because you don't have enough of you know, this vote to, yeah. With her, like, well, you just dig in more.
I go in and tell them my opinion and they'll agree with me because Sarah.
Yeah. Yeah, and with this, and comparing that with this, like, forward thinking, like, well, this is where we're headed.
Yeah,
And it was amazing. There was one other instance that was really, that was kind of fun, and I'm kind of embarrassed to talk about because I'm a little like, I don't want to be like the white splainer. There was one question that somebody asked afterward, which was, because they were discussing Flint, Michigan, and the water crisis, and, you know, what happened with that. And one of the questions was, do you know what the different reactions were between the two Democratic candidates to the crisis? And I was like, inside, I'm like Hermione Granger going, oh, I know this one! I know this one! I know this one! But, you know, on the outside, I'm like,
Let's see what happens here.
And I assumed, you know, Touré would know. And he's like, well, I don't actually know that. So I'm like, do I? No, I don't. I wait and I go up afterward, and I'm just going to let him know privately that there are, that has been recorded. And so I did. And I'm like, just so you know, that one question, there were two different responses by the two Democratic candidates. And it was in keeping with what you were talking earlier, saying earlier about like pragmatic progressivism, which is, you know.
I actually don't know this. What were the two responses? Because I'm curious.
This is interesting.
Because it's, I kept up with it to a point, more on the scientific aspects of how this gets resolved and how it happened than anything else. And that's another podcast for another day.
So between the two Democratic presidential candidates, Sanders came up and, you know, was very adamant that Governor Snyder should resign. He got up there and he was like, he should resign. He should resign his post. This is unconscionable. And yeah, Snyder probably should resign, morally speaking. And it is unconscionable. But and this is all documented interviews from the Flint mayor, Karen Weaver.
Yeah.
Clinton's response was two-pronged. She was the only one to call the mayor up and offer help.
Wow.
She said, what do you need? She dispatched two campaign aides to go down there and help the mayor assess the problems and get help to people, including like some, I don't know how much, but some bulk amount of drinking water to tide them over in the meantime.
I'm guessing, here's the thing, Hillary Clinton has a decent buttload of money kicking around. I'm sure that she, out of the, like, you can demonize rich people all you want. Like, it's funny, America's a country of demonizing rich people while trying to become the rich people. We're a very strange country when it comes to that.
Somebody said that we're a nation of the poor do not see ourselves as poor, but temporarily
disenfranchised millionaires. Yeah. Yep, I love that. And we're very strange about it. You know what? Most of us are going to be middle class all of our lives. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with being rich either. But you know what? If you're rich, it's hopeful that you'll be, you know, somewhat moral and responsible with how you act. The Clintons pay about 30% per year with their tax dollars. Donald Trump, last time he released his tax returns, zero. Nothing. And, you know, a lot of people, their question is, so how do I get a hold of his accountant? But you know what? Like, I feel like if you're going to say we should take care of this country, at least the Clintons put their fucking money where their mouth is. And if that was her response to the Flint water crisis, I kind of look at that as, this is a person who is putting her time, like, she's a busy woman. Like, whatever you have to say about your complaints about her, a lot of them are probably based on Republican talking points that aren't true, but but this is a busy fucking woman. Whatever you say about her, she is busy. And she took the time to, you know, to figure out within her campaign to send time and money and people who worked in her campaign to go actually help instead of just making a speech about it. You gotta respect that. Come on.
And at that point, she called Snyder out for not helping. It was either after or concurrent to.
Yeah.
And he ended up sending help, sending aid. And his aides were very much like, well, we did it because, you know. But it wasn't until after she called him out, which was, so it was a very interesting case study. And it was why the Flint Mayor Weaver said, this is why I'm endorsing Clinton. She's the only person who reached out to us who was running for president. And I gotta go with that.
It's, you know, if anyone, because I'm sure there are people watching who are still Bernie or Busters, I admire your passion, though I just disagree. It's, you know what, if ask someone in Flint if they like the drinking water they got from Hillary. And I'm sure there's somebody drinking water they don't know the Clinton campaign sent who is sitting there going, that fucking bitch.
Like, and when I went up to Ray afterward, I didn't go up to him. I was just like, I'm just going to let them know that it's out there. They can look it up for themselves. I'm not going to take their time. You know, I'm not going to bug them. But I was going out to the car to get my charger, and I hear him call my name, and I turn around, and he's like, hey, so what about that Flint thing? And I'm like, and he's like, come here, come on. And so I followed him to this doorway that said talent only, and I stopped at the doorway, and he's like, no, come on in. And I'm like, okay. I guess I'm coming in now. And the guy with the clipboard was like, oh yeah, sandwiches are over there, drinks are over there. And I'm like, I got a sandwich. Because I was really hungry at that
point. You're like, I'm talented. I can be talented.
I get a pastrami and jalapeno. And he was like, so tell me about the Flint response.
Nice.
And
I'm like,
okay. So I told him what I told you. And he's like, uh-huh, exactly. Okay, yep, exactly. And we just started, and he's like, it's the pragmatic progressive. You know, it's fighting hard and, you know, scrabbling for what change you can. And knowing that it's going to come in hard work and bits and pieces. And I said, that's exactly it. And, you know, fight for definitely what you can. Mm. But don't take for granted the victories. And that was the thing that he and Mark Thompson were coming back to, is don't take the victories for granted.
Yeah.
And I said as well, there was another thing about the response, which was that during the debates in Flint, Michigan, I don't know if you remember this, but she was the first one to call out, and look, she said, and look, let's not kid ourselves. If this happened in a rich suburb, this would not even be. This happened in a poor black neighborhood. So and that and the other. She's the first person to name white privilege in any of these by name. And it's like, holy shit.
And let's be blunt. People don't want to mention it. Bernie Sanders is continually elected in a predominantly rich, upper-class white state.
98% white.
98% white. Yeah. It's gotten a little bit more non-white. Used to be 99, I think. Vermont is pretty damn white. I'm just saying, y'all are nice. Y'all are pretty fucking white.
Some of our best friends are white.
It's where, I'm really.
Oh my God!
We're clearly not complaining. We're just saying those are the demographics of the state that elects Bernie. And you know what? It's a really monetarily endowed state. They're not the type of state that would, like, there are a lot of tax dollars floating around there. It's a really okay, like, the state is doing well. They wouldn't have the type of problems that Flint, Michigan, that's falling apart, would have. And, like, they need to figure out a better way to distribute the money so that the city doesn't go bankrupt and let its citizens drink poisonous water. So Bernie screaming, you know, fire the mayor is not a thing that's going to fix anything.
It would feel good.
Oh, yeah. It'd be great to just fire a guy. But you know what? What does firing a guy accomplish? It doesn't get the lead out of the drinking water. It doesn't change the years of damage to these people's DNA and to their body and their children's bodies that's already been incurred. That's horrifying to me. You know what? Like, somebody saying, what can we do to help the situation, and sending money and aid and people and time is, you know, part of the reason why I respect the Clinton camp, because this is kind of how she approaches a lot of things. It's like, what pronged approach do we need to take to it? And things don't get better right away. It would look great, and so it's a great soundbite to say, we fired the guy. Fix it. Wouldn't fucking fix it. That's one of the little things about it. But we're not here to rant about Bernie Sanders, because he lost and he's done.
And
okay?
For the record, quick disclaimer, while Bernie Sanders' constituency in Vermont is 98% white, I am not making the claim that his supporters nationally in his campaign are that. I know a great, diverse, wonderful group of people who are supporters of him.
Oh, yeah.
And I have to make that disclaimer. Hashtag not all Bernie supporters. So there you go.
And if he'd won, I totally would have been voting for him. Totally.
Holy shit.
Oh
yes.
Yeah, I would have done everything in my power to make sure he got elected, which pretty much just means I would have shown up and voted for him. But
because Donald Trump.
But I mean,
running on the Republican side.
Mm-hmm, but you know, we're asking you, since of course you know Hillary's kind of been our girl since day one. That you know, if since we would have gone over. Since, you know, if you actually look at the facts of this election and not just the what I want to think is true, Hillary's got some good solutions. Come on over. Come on. You'll be fine. Don't worry. It might hurt a little bit at first, but, you know, lube up. You'll be okay.
So, exiting the James Carville, Sarah Palin Thrilla in Vanilla.
So earlier
in happened?
Earlier in the day, Anna had run into Michael Steele and they'd had a quick chit-chat and he actually remembered her name. Because why wouldn't you remember Anna? Because she's wonderful.
It's an easy name to remember and it's a palindrome.
And
he's a politician, so he's really good at that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. Well, and Anna's adorable. Why wouldn't you remember her? Anyway, so we get out of there and like I'm rarely like flummoxed by people, but I know that when people are at these events, like, because I tend to be, by the end of them, I am tired. I don't, like, I don't have any energy left in me by the end of them a lot of times. And I was like, oh my God, it's Michael Steele. It's like, I want to go. Like, I didn't know what he was going to be like, if he was going to have time to talk. Like, he'd already been chit-chatted at all weekend. And I was like, come on, let's go.
I knew what he was like. I knew this was going to be fun.
It's like, and I was like, are you sure it'll be okay? She's like, come on. Because he was talking to a group of people, including John Fugelsang, Rick Unger, who's his co-host on Steele and Unger, or is it Unger and Steele?
Steele and Unger, I think. And
either way, they do a radio show, and you should listen to it.
And
anyways,
he's the former head of Marvel, so we had some interesting discussions.
Yeah. And either way, so it's eventually Anna's like, come on, let's go. And he's like, Anna! And he came over and chit-chatted. I'm like, what? We're just sitting here talking to Michael Steele? That's wonderful!
Former Republican National Committee Chairman Michael Steele, former Lieutenant Governor of Maryland, Michael Steele.
And here's the thing, like, and we just walked to, and here's part of the reason why we were kind of fangirling over Michael fucking Steele is because he's always been a Republican who I really goddamn like. Like,
a likable guy.
He's not just like, and here's the thing, I started to get to kind of know Michael Steele, you know, from afar. Well, if of course I'm tweeting this to him later, so he's gonna watch us fangirling and be like, this is getting creepy. Now, you guys, like, he's gonna be like, you guys know I'm married, right? Like, cut the shit.
Stop embarrassing yourselves, ladies.
Yeah, so but here's the thing, like, from afar, we'd watch him on Real Time with Bill Maher. That was where I first started to go, like, oh, Michael Steele, he's a Republican who we can be friends with. Like, at one point, we're talking about the fact that, you know, you have to work across the aisle to get anything passed. And it's because, you know, half of your constituents or half the constituents in the country are going to lean, you know, left and half are going to lean right, approximately. A little more in one election, a little less in another election. It's going to go either way. But, you know, you have to compromise to get anything done. He acknowledged, he's like, yeah, compromise has become a dirty word in politics. And I'm like, oh, someone admitted that. Michael Steele, I love you, Michael Steele. And he's like, so the word I like to use is consensus, so we can come around to a consensus and find out, you know, how we can get legislation passed. I'm like, oh, Michael Steele, you steely-eyed wonder, you are good. He talked about times when he worked with the teachers' union in Maryland and got meaningful legislation passed.
And that was an interesting moment. It kind of reflected the discussion with the libertarian earlier, but he's like, look, by way of example, I had to work with the teachers union, the head of the teachers union during my time, and like a lot of Republicans don't like that, and there was a meeting in my office where they came in and we started to have a meeting and it quickly devolved into butting heads
and fist pounding.
And he was like, I was looking at myself doing this and I'm like, no way. And I'm paraphrasing here because I don't think he says no way in kind of a valley
girl
accent.
Doesn't seem like a no way guy.
And he's like, look, we can stand here and yell at each other all we like, but in the end, we both want to do the right thing, and we both want to have something happen. So
we both have. What are the things we both want here?
Right.
And it was funny because we brought up like my mom was a teacher for 23 years. My boyfriend is a professor. I'm pretty pro teacher, but you know some of the things that we've put into education are not necessarily pro student or pro teacher, like all the testing we do. And Michael Steele's like, yep, no, I agree with you on that. I'm like, oh, Michael Steele, are you sure you're a Republican? I'm just saying. But,
which we'll get to later.
But they managed to pass reform that, you know, that worked for both the Republicans and the Democrats. And I'm sure there are people in the state that are still mad at it. But when you're working across the aisle, you have to work with a multitude of opinions. And he understands that. And that's something I can respect with somebody who I don't always agree with. Now, here's the thing, like, politics have become so divisive. And it's turned into a thing where either you agree with me or you're the most
you're
horrible.
Hitler.
Yeah, it's like everyone who doesn't agree with me is Hitler by the internet. Yeah. Like that's the book about the internet. Everyone who disagrees is Hitler.
I'm just going to put in here, if you're retweeting neo-Nazi propaganda, you're a little closer to Hitler than anybody else.
I'm just saying, the only person, just for the record, the only person who's Hitler-ish is Stalin, and everyone else pretty much gets a pass. And Pol Pot. We'll throw those three together. Everyone else is not Hitler. Donald Trump is not even Hitler. He has a few qualities that we might compare him to Hitler because he's such... He's a little crazy, but has he killed 6 million Jews? Has he threatened to kill 6 million Jews? Not yet. Not yet, but you know what? People are giving him some weird shit to say, so who knows? But moving
on.
Don't
give him any more ideas.
It's the day is young. Anyways, here's the thing. Michael Steele, when he was working, and I love this, when he was working as the head of the RNC, you know, he started saying we have to go into neighborhoods that are different from us, not to try to, you know, bludgeon our ideas into their heads, but because, you know, that's where voters are. So they'd go into minority neighborhoods. They'd go into Brooklyn and the Bronx and say, what are your concerns? We have something for you in the party. We're going to turn into a big tent Republican party.
Right.
And they, as much as I'm not happy that they won elections, because they got some people in who I don't agree with, I love the tactic that he said of let's go and talk to the voters. Because I think that, and that's kind of one of the things that the Hillary camp is doing right now, is they're making a really personal campaign and they're talking to people. And that's how you win hearts and minds, and that's how you talk to voters. But that was the thing that Michael Steele said. We have to go out into the neighborhoods and talk to people who don't feel like we're listening to them. And they won with minorities even.
And like, this is the weird thing. This is how weird things are now, because that is retail politics.
Yeah.
That's politicking. That's like 101. That's what you do.
Yeah.
That's how Ted Kennedy almost lost to his seat to Romney when he started taking all that for granted.
Yep.
And the fact that we're at this point where Michael Steele is like, and then we went to the voters and we actually talked to them to ask them about their concerns. The fact that he's expressing that as a, like, oh my God, Terra Nova, is kind of a weird spot to be in.
Here's the thing, he did such a good job of kind of building up the Republican Party, but he did that by building up the voters to get on board with the message, and that's a beautiful thing. And this is where we get to the point in the conversation where we told him, hey, you know, you're on board with compromise. You're on board with these things that the Democrats do, and you're on board with the type of messaging you do. Michael Steele, our buddy, our friend.
Come over to our site.
One day, trust me, it'll feel good. Like, it's gonna feel a little weird at first. But
And that was the thing. I'm like, look, it's not just... It wasn't until after we had spoken to him that was like, why is he still... And I'm like, look...
I don't want to...
We have room for diverse... opinions, and all the stuff that you were saying about compromise being a dirty word, you know that's like, and this was me being a partisan, I'm like, you know, that was kind of with Bush and you're either with the Tories or against it, your party kind of, and he even was like, I know that was our party doing that.
And I don't want to quote him from a private conversation and a thing that will get him in trouble.
Sure.
But at one point, he used the word motherfuckers.
And we're not going to say who he used it against.
But the fact that, number one, you have not lived until you've heard Michael Steele say motherfuckers. And number two, like, I love that you can have these conversations with people with whom you don't agree with. This is why I love stuff like Politicon. You can sit there watching Michael Steele and John Fugelsang in the fucking hallway having a chit-chat, and then you can hear the former head of the RNC say motherfuckers. This is why you should get involved in politics, because it's hilarious. It's the best show on earth.
It's kept fun by stuff like that.
Oh yeah, it was like a geek convention. We were just missing cosplay with somebody dressed up like
there was
the TARDIS.
Cosplay.
Okay,
there was cosplay of politicians.
We just needed somebody dressed up like a TARDIS with Trump hair. That's all we needed for it to be a perfect convention. Next year, I challenge someone to show up like that. I'm just saying, watch it. Like, 10 people are going to show up with that next year because of this video.
Yeah, I swear to God. I hope so.
And if you do, come tweet at me on Twitter that it's, where else are you going to tweet at me? Twatter me that it's going to happen next year. Oh, yeah.
dirty twatter.
Oh, yes. There actually is a website called Twatter. I think it's twatter.com.
So what was so interesting that I found about this was that not only was this a place where people came together and, you know, were on panels and yeah. you were Van Jones going off against Ann Coulter, but
in the hallway,
but the head of the RNC was taking time out of his day to just discuss policy, and while it wasn't even a short conversation. It was a long one.
At one point, he even put these on and started. Now, unlike me, who was doing Trump impressions, he put these on. And we have, like, I don't know if we're going to post the pictures in this video. There was, of course, one of me next to him stroking his cheek with the creepy Trump hat. And you're seeing he's laughing at this all. He's having a great giggle at it. And he's, you know, he's like, end of the day, I believe in smaller government. I believe in, and he was talking about the things he believed in, and they were kind of the older school Republican things.
Right.
That I'm like, you know, once upon a time, government worked pretty well when you have people battling things out across the aisle and coming to, as he called it, a consensus. And now that's not what we have. It's just, it's my way or fuck you. And that's kind of a problem. Like, as much as these are funny and it's great to make a, you know, joke every once in a while with them, I wish this wasn't what was happening in politics right now. But I do love that Michael Steele was aware enough of what was going on and able to make a joke about it, and able to laugh about what was happening in the party that he's, you know, still wants to be a part of. And, you know, I feel like the party is, like, you know, it's the things that are still basic to it are still, you know, are still hardcore tenets to it are still in his heart and his mind, and the party is just
right.
floated off in another direction. The rudder is missing. The Republicans, you guys need a Michael Steele, I'm just saying.
And the thing is, we were like, okay, the Republican tent is dwindling in both demographics and ideology, and it's kind of shaking itself and tearing itself apart right now. And while it may, and it probably will, you know, reform stronger and better. Come over to, maybe, why don't you come over to our side? Because we have a larger tent for right now for, you know, ideas. And we have, you know, kind of a more diverse kind of electorate. And we have a better discipline right now as a party.
His
answer was really, I gotta give him props for it, and I understand completely.
Yeah, and
he wants the house. He wants to fix the house. I get it.
He's like, gotta rebuild the house. And I said to him, like, but what if the house is being condemned and it's on fire? Like, right now, there are rats with rabies coming out, and the rats have herpes on them.
Police
and, like,
line, do not cross. Volcanoes coming out of the
desert.
There's
like, there are dead hookers in the house. I mean, it's a bad show at the moment. Maybe it's time to abandon ship, Michael.
Come on.
We have tiny baby Trump hands. Like, we can take a joke.
And he even admitted that we have better parties.
I'm sure he's fiested a little bit. Our party has better parties. Like, he strikes me as,
I don't want to brag, but they are.
Like, anytime we ran into him in the hallway after that, we kept running into him. We got a big hug from our new friend Michael Steele. Like, he was,
I'm
like,
not a hugger. I was okay with it.
I was a hugger, and here's the thing: I always, because, like, you know, I went to shake his hand, and every time he's like, he'd go for the handshake, and then a big hug. Like, he's cuddly, and while he's talking to you, he has a hand on your shoulder.
But it's not a creep. Like, it's the politician thing. It's not the creepy, like,
yeah. It's like there's no creepiness.
A politician.
But, yeah, it's like, let's clarify. There was no creepiness for Michael Steele.
Yeah.
He can hang out with us, and no, it's not like. But yeah, it's just like. It's funny, like, my boyfriend, who's apolitical, or, you know, less political than me, he's not quite as apolitical as John, but, like, my boyfriend was like, yeah, that guy was great. This is something I've learned just from all the different types of people I talk to when I'm going to conventions. There are, you get a huge number of people who you disagree with on a lot of things, But everyone, it comes down to the fact that you're always going to be talking to a human being, and the stuff that you see about them just from their political opinions, you miss so much about the personality and the human behind it. And we got to see a little bit about Michael Steele, the guy, like the person. Oh, here's one that that I asked him that I kind of enjoyed his answer to, that it was from the perspective of him kind of commanding the party, so to speak, that I think is not privileged information. I asked, you know, if you see a bad candidate running that you think is going to be right. damaging in their seat, you know, that you think they're going to say things that are fucked up. Like, he remembered, do you guys remember Christine O'Donnell? The one who was like, I was a witch.
Oh, tell the Christine O'Donnell story.
Just to remind you guys, Christine O'Donnell, she was running, I think, from Delaware.
I'm not a witch.
For a Senate seat, mm-hmm. and she was like, I was a witch back in the 80s, and of course she was kind of a crazy tea partier.
I'm nothing you've heard. I'm you.
Yeah. And at one point, Michael Steele's like, Michael Steele did not put up with shit when he was running the party, and I liked that. Fair like, now enough. It's kind of the inmates running the asylum, but he's like, no, when she was doing her crazy shit, I said, you're gonna come to D.C. and we're gonna have a discussion, because this shit ends now.
And he made the distinction, which takes me back to McKinley's days, of I do not come see, he's like, Rince Priebus is now, you know, going to see Trump. Oh, no. No. Trump. The candidates come see the head.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like, that's a stone cold badass move, and I love that. But here's, this was a thing that I asked him that I wanted to know. I'm like, is it ever better to lose a seat when you have a dreadful candidate running and say, okay, we'll get it next time? Or do you run that candidate and just hope for the best and, you know, put all of your will behind them and put all of your effort behind them, even knowing that they could fuck things up? He's like, you always run the candidate and put your support behind them, because even if you disagree with that one candidate, you have the Republican, you know, you have your party machine. I'm like, that's an interest. I don't know.
You have your beachhead.
Like, I look at that and go, ugh. Like, that's why I'm looking at this with Donald Trump going, I do wonder, like, because with that insight from Michael Steele, who used to, you know, run this bitch, like, what he's thinking when he sees, you know, Trump out there, you know, with tiny little Trump hands, just thinking, you know, this is the best, this is what the American people or the Republican electorate, you know, wanted. And now we have to, like, we have to run them under that thought of, it's always better to get a win and there's going to be machinery behind them. But man, he's going to have to do diplomatic things. Like,
you dance with them what brung ya is I think how Molly Ivins described it in her book on Bush.
It's like, somewhere deep down, there has to, like, I don't want to try to figure out what's in someone's brain. So people like Michael Steele, who are very, like, and people who are, like, I have, like I said, friends who are hardcore Republican politicos who know, you know, the political system better, much better than I do, I would say, are looking at this going, fuck, what do we do?
See, I'm going to, for practical purposes, I'm going to disagree. He's on the Republican ticket.
Okay.
He has the R next to his name.
He has to, okay.
That's,
I'll give you that.
He's a it's the same way, you know, there are people who complain, well, Bernie Sanders only became a Democrat in order to run. Like,
you know,
okay,
what? Had the D next to it, he's a Democrat.
He has the D next to his name, so he's a representative
of the party.
Right now of the Democratic Party, even when all this is happening. And the interesting thing is, looking at, you know, after what he said, and then comparing that with the Never Trump movement that some Republican politicians are planning to take to the floor of the convention. And that's the crazy thing, is that there are people who are avoiding the convention altogether this year. There are companies like Google and Coca-Cola who have pulled out of funding both
Apple
conventions.
As well.
Apple.
I don't know if Apple pulled out of the Democratic one, but they definitely pulled out of pulling the RNC.
I know that there were some who pulled out of the DNC because of the national convention, because, well, we have to pull out of the Republican convention because Trump's brand is so toxic, and because of fairness, we feel obliged to do that here too.
That's
so
just a crazy
the
thought.
RNC is getting less, you know, liquidity from that, and there are people who are like, nope, I am not going to the convention. Yeah. Which is the place to be. And so I hear him saying, like, okay, you run with whoever you're running, and you do your best. And I'm like, wow, I get that he feels that way, and I'm watching the exact opposite happen. Now, granted, the Never Trump movement is not going to...
It's not
going to
work.
It's not going to work, because you're kind of... If you did, this is what the voters decided, and if you decide to subvert the will of the voters, it's and especially those ones, you're...
Good luck! I'm going
to
stay...
I wouldn't go to the convention either!
It's going to be a Gallagher show. I'm going to get under a tarp, okay?
Yeah, and so that was really interesting. Oh, that's good.
They're going to be protected.
Yes. And he's in his Rough Rider outfit, so he will... So,
In one breath, there was the word motherfuckers, and we're not going to say who it was referring to. and then there's another breath of saying, you know, you run who you have, and there's going to be the machinery behind it. And I'm like, the problem with Trump is that you cannot give him a script. And I mean, I feel for... On some level, I feel for people like Michael Steele who were like, my party got away from me! But then I look at all the other people who were like, this is great! When the Sarah Palins of the world showed up and they were like, look, we have someone who's energizing the base. I'm like, you know what you're doing? You're letting the inmates run the asylum. Yeah. This is not good. This is not smart business either.
I mean, as much as William F. Buckley was William F. Buckley, it's not, this is not the party. At least that was from an era when intellectualism and the discussion of ideas was something that was happening in that party as well. It's and like now it's once, a well, reactive, it's a, it's in a reactive phase.
Like the James Carville, Mary Madeline marriage wouldn't happen today. Like once upon a time. Dude. And I mean, it still happens sometimes, not as much. Like Republicans and Democrats in Washington used to, at least these are the rumors that I hear up in, you know, out here in La La Land.
I hear of the times.
I hear of the times.
The old times.
It's like they used to go to dinner parties together. They used to hang out. And now it's like, it's a much more divided DC, at least as they'll have you believe on the news. Like, but it's like, you know what? If you guys can talk, and it's like, and here's the other thing. I would hope that all those people who we elect and our tax dollars are paying for you to do your jobs. Oh, we need a 9th Supreme Court judge. Moving on. I'm just saying, I hope that y'all remember that America is composed of a lot of people that don't agree on politics and are still friends and work together. So maybe y'all could do a little bit more working together. That's all I'm saying. And
that's kind of crazy.
And that's kind of why I liked Michael. That's kind of why we're still sitting here in awe of Michael Steele a week later, because he's like, had to work together. Even if you don't agree on everything, even if you don't get everything you want.
It helps to just see the human side of things.
Yeah.
So... That kind of brings me to why I won't make fun of Lindsey Graham anymore. There is a...
My love for Graham now. I've been loving the Lindsey Graham Fuck It tour of 2016.
I gotta say, when you have nothing left to lose. But the guy is on the opposite end of the spectrum from me. I'm not on board with his policies, but... There is, I don't know if you've seen the clip of him talking about Joe Biden.
I haven't. Oh, we're going to sit down and geek out to this later. You have a look on your face.
They've served to, well, they're old school, you know, they were from the era of Ted Kennedy and whatnot.
Yeah, they've been there.
And it's on the road with, so it's basically on the road with the candidates or whatever, and it's a handheld camera, him in the back seat of the car, bawling, because Joe Biden's son has died.
Oh my God. Holy shit.
And the first thing he says is, if you don't like Joe Biden, well, there's something wrong with you.
And I have a tissue.
He goes.
They're right over there.
We can cut this. We can.
It's okay. People can see this.
All right.
That's fine. Holy
shit.
So
we'll play the clip later, but it is the most moving tribute to anything. And he says, we don't agree on much. We don't see eye to eye all the time, but he is the nicest, flat out, the nicest person you'll ever meet.
Wow.
And he called me up after, you know, I had my service, and he... And we talked, and it was after Beau had died, and All he cared about was making sure his grandkids were okay. And, and all this stuff. And he's just weeping.
Jesus.
And, like, Biden's pain is his own.
Yeah. They're, at the end of the day, they're people. And I think we forget about that when we're arguing.
That's the thing. The cynicism, I can't be cynical about that. And if I can't be cynical about Lindsey Graham now, that's something that was I have no right to be anymore.
And I mean, here's the thing. There are candidates that I feel like I can still be cynical about. And it's when I feel like they're putting on a show constantly for the American people, it's easy to be cynical about it. And it's easy to look at this and go, I don't think you care about the end result of you affecting the lives of Americans or affecting long-term policy or affecting, this is going to change shit for people. This is not just a job. This is a duty and a responsibility. So when I see-
You said duty.
I said duty. we're gonna make a poop joke and then we're gonna make a Donald Trump joke. But when I see somebody, I mean, as much as I joke about, you know, I respect Sarah, jokingly saying I respect Sarah Palin for saying, fuck it, I'm cashing in. Like, that's not what politics are supposed to be for. There are moments where Lindsey Graham is crying about Joe Biden's son, because even though these guys disagreed, and even though I find a lot of Lindsey Graham's opinions repugnant, man, that's a person who worked across the aisle, or, you know, worked with a friend of his who he vehemently disagreed with for years.
Yeah.
Like, that's, like, when I go to things like this, we meet people who we disagree with and we see the human side of them. Like, yeah. And Michael was, at the end of the day, Michael Steele was like, I'm going back to my hotel. And I'm like, isn't it nice? I'm like, because I travel so much for work. I'm like, it's nice to go back and hide in the hotel when you're on the road and nobody can find you in your little cave. He's like, oh, you travel. I'm like, and so we were just, I got to chit chat and find the little human moments, the little things that all connect us in the universe. Crying in the backseat of his car. Jesus Christ.
And he was just not ashamed of it. He's like, look. Which was refreshing. And it was, because he gets made fun of for certain things, even by the left. And here's where we bring in a little bit of, like, you know, it's a little bit I don't know the word for it, but kind of sexism. He's made fun of a lot for having certain, not being as seemingly masculine as other people. And if you can sit there and discuss how your coworker's best friend's pain is your own, someone who you vehemently disagree with on top of that, but you work together and at loggerheads at the same time, that's fucking ballsy vaggy, you know, that's awesome.
Dude, I was about to say, I don't know if I want to say that he's got balls or if he's got ovaries, because those can take a pounding.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, I know from experience. But
as the joke goes.
Lindsey Graham, I if ever we're in the same part of town, either a bourbon or I'm a Diet Coke addict. One of those is on me. But that's, Jesus Christ, man. But like, that's what I dig about politics. And I'll say this about, like I said, I do science. It's behind every good science story, there's always a human story. And I think it's the same thing in politics. It's like with science, we're always trying to, like, it's what's happening in Flint is both a story of a science thing, of a molecule, lead, that's horribly hurt people. And it's going to take scientists and engineers to find a way to fix this in a timely fashion. And it's going to take politicians to figure out how to get the resources there. But it's always a human story that drives both the science and the politics. And whenever people are going to look back on this era in history, and I love this, because I mean, they're gonna be like, one day people are gonna look back on this era like we look back on different eras and go, what the fuck was happening? And like, they're gonna be all these human stories that drive it.
Yep.
And I love going to stuff like this, because we get to see our other little humans outside of their zoos.
You get to see how they came to their conclusions.
They crawl out of their zoo that is Washington. Yeah. And we get to go, okay, what's your story? And
and sometimes, who let you out?
Oh, there's a zoo in Alaska that still needs Sarah Palin to be there. Anyways.
So, there was an interesting, it was interesting talking to Michael Steele as well, about, you know, being there and finding common ground with people and seeing each other as human. And the guy to my left, who had been kind of like, you know, chatting, you know, leaned in and he's like, so, you know, this is really something. And I'm like, I know, right? And it wasn't very far into just pleasant small talk when he just leans right over and goes, see, I'm libertarian and we have all the answers. And it was like, and I looked at him and I'm like, and we were doing so well. Because it felt like he was breaking the rules. You know, like I get
yeah, the rules of this
passionate discussion.
The rules of this, this type of convention, they're not rules.
They're
but
not rules.
The rule is that, oh, we're discussing our viewpoints without telling you you suck if right. you don't agree with it.
Right. And we have all the answers, so, you know.
But that's kind of a libertarian attitude.
But that's, and that kind of, and that was what he led with.
Like, it's like, oh,
and
sweetie.
We have all the answers, and this is, and our way is the right way. And I told him, and we were doing so well up until this point. And yeah. He's like, well, you have to admit, you know, it's the only reason why we haven't, you know, no, more people don't know that it's the right way is because our policy, it's never really been tried.
You and know, I'm like, there was an era before child labor laws. I'm just saying.
I told him, really, you know, come, don't discount your successes. And he's like, what do you mean? And I said, come on, Somalia is a perfect. I mean, if libertarian, I mean, you have no government to speak. You have no government regulations. You have no enforcement of any regulations that are on the book. Wealthy businessmen come in and do what they want. It's the free market. And in that free market span where you have companies dumping toxic waste onto the shorelines of these. No, go with me. I'm starting to see the light.
No, that's not what I wanted. There's
when
not...
you have these companies that are, you know, dumping toxic waste onto the shoreline and poor fishermen have to, you know, turn to anything else to make a fucking living to
piracy.
Feed their families. Piracy and warlords.
But piracy is not anarcho-capitalism.
That is
a bootstrapping
entrepreneur, my friend. So own your successes. Don't disown it. And by this time, he's like, and he's like, Somalia? Really? And I'm like, absolutely. I mean, come on, own your success. And he's like, and his response was, I bet you're a Hillary Clinton supporter, aren't you? And I'm like, oh, what gave it away? Giving a shit about people? And his response was, you know, and we're upping it at this point. And he's like, so you have no principles? And I'm like, oh, evidently. And, you know, he started in again. And I'm just like, talk to the hand. We're done. And
30 seconds.
30 seconds later, we were both like, I'm so sorry. Oh, my God. I can't believe this.
You're like,
this
we, were, what we I, broke the rules.
We broke the rules. And we're so, I did that. And he's like, no, I couldn't. I shouldn't have come out. I was way condescending.
We need
I'm
to
like,
rock
but
paper,
I was condescending
scissors,
too.
Out.
Yeah. And it was this weird, awesome, like, oh, boy, I really fucked
it's
up.
Like, I didn't mean to.
This
I'm
wasn't
so
intended to be the comment section on a post. This isn't why we're here. And he's like, hey, you know, can we start over? My name's, you know, and I'm like, yeah. And he's a libertarian mayor from a small town. I don't remember the town's name. I don't remember his name.
So what
name.
We're saying is in a few years, he's going to be the next VP pick for
exactly.
Random guy that hung out with Anna. We know they're going to pluck you out of obscurity because we're sure you have about as much more experience than Sarah Palin, and you seemed better spoken than her.
Ah. You definitely seemed better. There was like subject predicate.
shall we do a quick wrap up on Lady Justice?
Yeah,
Lady
Parts
Justice
let's.
League. So, Lady Parts Justice League, they loudly and proudly, and this is MRA's comment below where I will promptly ignore your comments because I really don't give a shit.
We have a very special folder for your comments.
It's called the delete folder, or it's my trash. I put them right into my pussy. And I use them, I grind them up and use them as tampons and flush it all out. Oh, yeah. It's you're welcome for that visual. I think there are men going, oh, I'm like, I'm sorry, did a pussy freak you out? So that's why Lady Parts Justice League is around. It's because they haven't seen a pussy for a while. Anyways, this is why we have Lady Parts Justice League, founded by Liz Winstead, co-creator of The Daily Show. And it's her and a bunch of amazingly hilarious kick-ass comics, because me stutter pretty today, that get out and do some, you know, the humor isn't all pussy jokes. I mean, they occasionally get a dick joke in there and a taint joke, because who isn't
equal
into that?
Time.
Equal time. And, you know, they talk about they do some really funny stuff, and they also do some kick-ass activism to try to make sure that things like Planned Parenthood clinics and independently operating women's health clinics get the support that they need, because they often don't. And there's been a lot of legislation to make sure that people don't have access to the health care that that women.
You may not have known about that. It wasn't really well covered.
Yeah,
were no hearings.
Yeah, it's so...
I'm sorry. I meant exactly opposite of what I said.
Exactly.
Sorry.
So anyways, they do a lot of really nice activism, try to get the word out. I love what Lady Parts Justice League does, because they try to make this approachable with humor and with good... And I mean, the reason that they started calling it Lady Parts, and I love this. I love this slash hate it, was because the legislator, I forget which state it was they started in, the legislators in that state couldn't bring themselves to say vagina. They're trying to legislate all the things that happen around my personal amusement park, and they couldn't say the
name
of it.
They couldn't name it.
I'm like,
they,
you know,
requested that it instead be called Lady Parts.
I'm like, which Lady Parts? I mean, this is one of my Lady Parts. I'm just saying.
These are two of my favorites.
Two, exactly.
I work these out.
I was about to say, it's one of my favorite ones.
Nice.
Anyways, so they started calling themselves Lady Parts Justice League because of that, and I thought it was hilarious and brilliant.
Their panel, I have to say, was because I have not seen their show yet. I am going to rectify that. But their panel was pretty wonderful, and it was very much in that spirit of being, I mean, everybody, there was nobody I am willing to wager real money on, who was at that event who was not a political nerd,
yeah,
and passionate one at that. And they came out with, you know, with their comedy and with their in-your-face kind of thing. And that was, you know, just one thing that was there amongst a whole diverse plethora of viewpoints.
Yeah.
Many of which were diametrically opposed to them.
Oh, yeah.
And we all were geeking out together.
And as we were exiting for the day, because Anna walks around in this kick-ass side pockety...
My friend makes holsters.
It's just a cool looking
bag. It just holds your
bag,
stuff
and
in
she
it.
And she has these nice little covers in her boots. Basically, she looks a little like a modern day Lark of Tomb Raider. And we were walking out... and
out.
Security guard yells at her, "Hey, Lara Croft." And of course, because I told you there would be a joke about this, I yell back, "I know you'd love to raid her tomb."
No, you yelled, "She'll raid your tomb."
No, I'm like,
oh.
You would love to raid her tomb, because it had to put the
Got
action
it.
On him.
Got it.
And it's like all the other security guards are like, "Oh!" I'm like, "Yeah, I thought so." I'm like, "What? You know it's true." Anyways,
we're gonna roll with jokes here.
So that was there was even some humor with security guards. What? So that was the end of our lovely day. And then we went out and had Mexican food. Because of course, when in SoCal. And here's the thing: we kept no taco bowls.
Sorry, Trump.
I had a taco salad, but there was no bowl because celiac disease. Moving on. But we it was funny. When we were walking into the parking garage, we saw Michael Steele again because he was going the same direction. We're like, we shouldn't say anything because it's been creepy enough continuing to run into him. But I thought about it for a second. Anyways, so that was the end of the day. It was wonderful. We got to see a lot of people and learn some things about the humans behind the talking heads.
And maybe, just maybe, a little bit about ourselves.
Oh yeah, and we're hoping, and we're still hoping
the
that Michael Steele.
Know.
We're still hoping Michael Steele will come over.
Come on, Michael. You know what? I'm gonna be happy if he stays over there, just that we have a voice of reason.
I would rather
have the Huntsmans and Steels of the world.
I'm just saying, it's in 2024. You know, after Hillary Clinton has served her two terms,
right?
You know, I wouldn't say no to a Huntsman Steel candidacy, or Steel Huntsman, whichever one.
Yeah,
it's
why
It's I don't know who's going to be voting or running from the Democrat side, but man, it's just to plant this little fucking seed out there. Michael Steele, who I'm going to be tweeting this to later. Man, you and John Huntsman
would make a really fine team.
That's a sexy motherfucking political ticket. I'm just saying.
Policy wonk wise.
A diplomat and the former head of the RNC.
I could. I'm not saying that I would be a swing vote, but
you might just turn us. You might just turn me into a Michael Steele. You and John Huntsman. I'm just saying it could happen. It could happen. I think that was
Politicon 2016.
That was Politicon 2016. Thank you for hanging out with us.
Again, I'm Anna Maltese, and
I'm Yvette Dontremont. I run scibabe.com. Come hang out with me over there sometime.
Just a quick wrap up. Hope you enjoyed. I know more women with opinions on my channel.
Fuck.
They always seem so surprised to find out I'm a feminist, because I don't think I've told them directly yet.
Yeah.
So don't tell them. Don't ruin the surprise.
Oh, we'll edit this out in post.
I'm being held against my will. Contact Randy Olson at Raleigh Studio.
It is legal, and before it was legal, people were having them. It has never been shown that the rates of abortions go down when you make it illegal.
The rates of deaths from unsafe abortions do, however, go up.
Half as a joke, mostly as a joke, just to rib people, because I know people are going to go, she said that. I'm almost sad that I've never had an abortion.
What?
I just want to be part of the crowd. Anyways.